So good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Financial Stability Report press conference. On my left is Andrew Bailey, Deputy Governor for Prudential Regulation. On my far right is Spencer Dale, the bank's Executive Director for Financial Stability and Risk. Next to him is John Cunliffe, Deputy Governor for Financial Stability. And next to me is the Governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney.
Thank you very much, Nils. Good morning, everybody. With the recovery in the United Kingdom broadening and gaining momentum in recent months, the Bank of England is now focused on turning that recovery into a durable expansion. And in order to do so, our tools must be used in concert. The legacy of high indebtedness and structural imbalances mean that there are financial stability risks that, if left unchecked, could undermine the durability of that expansion. And the biggest risks relate to the housing market. The FPC today is taking further graduated and proportionate actions to mitigate these risks. By doing so, the FPC can allow the MPC to focus on its primary objective of achieving price stability. Now, it's not the FPC's role to control house prices, nor can it address underlying structural issues related to the supply of homes. Our role, given to us by Parliament, is to manage risk to financial stability, including the buildup of unsustainable levels of leverage, debt, or credit growth. The prospects for household indebtedness concern us. Although UK households have made progress in repairing their balance sheets, they start from a vulnerable position, with debt at 140% of their disposable income. The share of mortgage lending to high loan-to-income ratios has increased markedly over the past year to a record high. Given the momentum in the housing market and the underlying shortage of housing supply, it's likely that this trend will continue. The FPC does not believe that household indebtedness poses an imminent threat to stability. Underwriting standards are more responsible than they were in the past. However, as we've seen time and again, how quickly responsible can turn to reckless, creating risks that ultimately derail the UK economy. The FPC is concerned that a marked loosening in underwriting standards and an associated significant increase in the number of highly indebted households could pose major direct and indirect risks in the future. So we're taking action today to prevent this from happening tomorrow. The direct risk arises because mortgage lending is the single largest asset class held by UK banks and building societies. This risk is mitigated by the considerable progress in recent years to strengthen those balance sheets. To ensure banks are sufficiently resilient to withstand a severe housing shock, the FPC and the PRA are currently conducting a major stress test and will recommend any further capital actions that might be necessary later this year. The indirect risks to financial and economic stability arises because mortgages are the single largest liability of UK households, representing 80% of household debt. Now, history shows that the British people do everything they can to pay their mortgages. But that means cutting back sharply on expenditures when the unexpected happens, potentially slowing the economy sharply. That's why recessions that follow periods of rapid credit growth, like the record recession that the UK is just emerging from, those recessions tend to be deeper and longer lasting. It's prudent to insure against those risks, and the FPC today is making two recommendations to limit the risk to financial stability and to the economy from a significant increase in the number of highly indebted households. First, we're introducing a new affordability test. Mortgage lenders should assess whether borrowers could still afford their mortgages if bank rate were to be 3 percentage points higher than at the point of origination of the loan. And second, we're introducing a cap. No more than 15% of any lender's total number of new residential mortgages should be at or greater than 4.5 times a borrower's income. These actions should not constrain current housing market activity. The recommendation on the affordability test is in line with current practice of prudent lenders, and the current share of new mortgage lending with loan-to-income ratios in excess of 4.5 times is around 10%. Now, these actions will have a minimal impact in the future if, that's important if the housing market evolves in line with the bank's central view. Specifically, the MPC's latest inflation report assumed a gradual increase in housing transactions and a moderation in house price inflation over the next year or so. The share of new mortgages at high loan-to-income ratios is expected to increase to around 15% to the level of the cap within the next year. The 15% cap, in other words, could quickly become relevant if house prices grow more than we expect, if incomes grow less rapidly than we expect, or if underwriting standards slip. So the actions of the FPC shouldn't prevent households who can afford a mortgage from obtaining them, or they shouldn't impose limits on the availability of lending to support the expansion. The measures are proportionate. They don't prohibit all high loan-to-income mortgage lending. In some cases, such as for first-time buyers, these mortgages can be appropriate. Currently, around 5% of all new mortgages are to first-time buyers who borrow at more than 4.5 times their income. Such lending can continue and even increase under the measures that were announced today. Of course, the decision to extend those loans is for the lenders themselves. But these actions will bite if there is sustained momentum in the housing market over the coming years, and that's accompanied by further sharp increases in high loan-to-income lending. They'll prevent lending from getting too far ahead of income growth, and they'll prevent a slide into riskier lending and higher indebtedness that could undermine the economic expansion over the medium term. It's because it's acting early that the FPC can take graduated and proportionate steps to reduce the risk of more drastic actions that might be required later on. We also recognize that while these tools like these have proven effective in other countries, they're still relatively novel in the United Kingdom. So by acting, assessing, and if necessary, recalibrating, we can strike the right balance to support durable growth. Today's actions demonstrate close coordination between authorities. The FPC welcomes the commitment of the PRA and the FCA to oversee the implementation of today's recommendations. The PRA will implement new rules as soon as practicable, and in the interim, will expect firms to act in accordance with the FPC's recommendations. This means these measures are effective from today. The FPC welcomes the Chancellor's announcement today that no new loans at or above 4.5 times the borrower's income can be included in the Help to Buy Mortgage Guarantee Scheme. And let me, on the final point on coordination, let me conclude by briefly explaining how we coordinate at the bank our monetary and macroprudential policies. The existence of macroprudential tools allows monetary policy to focus on its primary responsibility of price stability. In other words, monetary policy does not need to be diverted to address a sector-specific risk in the housing market. As the MPC has indicated, monetary policy is the last line of defense against risk to financial stability. Now, actions of the FPC can, in principle, affect the path of monetary policy that is necessary to achieve price stability. But whether or not those actions of the FPC do have that effect depends on their calibration, and that calibration depends on the nature of the risks that they're designed to address. And in that regard, there are two broad classes. First, when the FPC judges there to be a clear and present danger to financial stability, it will take actions that immediately curtail credit expansion. And because such actions will affect the level of economic activity, and therefore the outlook for inflation, monetary policy can, all else equal, be expected to follow a different path. Today's recommendations belong to a second class of macroprudential actions, that is, measures to insure against tail risks and therefore reduce the probability of future financial instability. These actions don't affect the central outlook for the economy. In fact, they make it more likely to happen. Therefore, they're less likely to have implications for the path of monetary policy, which currently anticipates limited and gradual rate rises over the forecast horizon. The MPC will, of course, conduct a full assessment of the impact of today's actions on the economy when the MPC next meets on the 9th and 10th of July. Now, regardless of the type of action, there's a need for the MPC, the FPC, and the PRA to work closely together. In the run-ups to today's announcements, they've done so by sharing analysis, holding a series of joint discussions to assess the housing market, and the interaction of their responsibilities. Working as one bank, we will continue that approach in the future because we recognize that it's only by using our policy tools in concert that we can best contribute to the durability of the economic expansion. And with that, I'd be very happy to take your questions.
Thank you. Now, I'd be very grateful if you could identify yourselves before you ask a question. As always, in the interest of letting as many people as possible ask a question, please keep it to one question and then pass back the microphone. Richard.
Thank you very much. Richard Edgar from ITV News. Governor, many people waiting for this announcement would have been very worried about the impact on their ability to buy a house. But as I understand it, the measures that you've announced today will not have any impact at all at the moment. It's status quo.
They will have an impact on the durability of the expansion. They make the likelihood of the durability expansion much greater. But let's go to the individual. If yesterday you went into a bank or building society and you were approved for a mortgage, you would be approved for that mortgage again today under these terms. There is room under the cap for institutions to continue to lend at high loan-to-income mortgages, and the best institutions, the most prudent institutions, were testing affordability using an assumption of bank rate that's 3% higher than origination. But what these mean is that the shift from that responsible lending that we're seeing today, responsible underwriting that we're seeing today, a potential shift of that into reckless, widespread, high loan-to-income, high loan-to-value, riskier lending tomorrow, a shift that we've seen in this country countless times in past housing cycles, that can't happen because there's a cap on the amount of high loan-to-income mortgages that can be extended, because there are mortgage market review standards which require lenders to conduct affordability tests, because we've adjusted the interest rates, the recommended interest rates that they use for those affordability tests, and because we are conducting stress tests of those lenders to ensure that they have adequate capital to guard against a severe housing shock. So what that means for the individual who's buying a house today, if they could have got the mortgage yesterday, they can get it today. But they also can have more confidence in the durability of the expansion because we're acting today in a proportionate and graduated fashion to reduce risks in the future.
Jennifer Ann from Bloomberg News. Can you talk about what the impact of these measures will be on the London property market? And then also, given the incredible increase in London property, won't this basically completely shut out all but the most wealthy, not all cash buyers from the London market?
Yeah. Well, if you look at a couple things on London property, and maybe I'll talk about London and the Southeast because it's almost one property market. Just under two-thirds of the high loan-to-income lending, in other words, lending above 4.5 times today, is in London and the Southeast. And that there is room for some additional lending, as I say, but there is this cap that comes into place, and under reasonable scenarios, reasonable risk scenarios, it can become effective within a year, which would limit the amount of high loan-to-income lending that can take place across the country, and by extension, in London. Make a broader point outside of London, if I may, which is that you can look at this cap as a cap on lending at high loan to incomes, but you also can look at it as an encouragement on lending at lower rates. For every one loan above 4.5 times, a lender has to extend 6 loans, a little more than 6 mortgages, at less than 4.5 times to keep the ratios in line. But for the dynamics of the London property market, there's room, but there's not infinite room, because there's risks with extending very high loan-to-income ratios to a very broad set of borrowers, and the market will have to adjust to that in the fullness of time. Last point, if I may, actually, on cash purchasers. I mean, the most recent data, it moved a bit, but the volume transactions on cash purchasers is about 3%. Value is about 8% in London. So it's important, and it's important in some postal codes, absolutely, but should be kept in some perspective.
Ed Conway from Sky News. Governor, there's been some concern recently, and you addressed it at your Treasury Select Committee hearing, about miscommunication, about misinterpretation of what the bank's message is on interest rates. Are you concerned that with the message that you're giving today on financial stability, you're saying that the housing market is the biggest risk to the economy, and yet, in terms of these actions, they aren't going to make a difference when it comes to mortgage lending right now? Are you concerned that people are going to look at this as well and say, once again, it's all talk from the Bank of England and no action?
No, this is action, and this is the right type of action, which is acting early. Because we're acting early, we don't have to reverse mistakes that have been made. We're acting to prevent those from happening. We're taking out insurance, said a different way. We're putting in place, in effect, a firebreak on high loan-to-income lending, on riskier lending, that type of lending, but we're not shutting it off entirely. And the reason we're not shutting it off entirely is because some of it is appropriate. I use the example of first-time buyers. 54% at present of first-time buyer mortgages are at this 4.5 times or above level. Makes sense. Future earnings prospects of first-time buyers who tend to be younger are greater, and they grow into their mortgage. That's a judgment that the institution has to make. So we're not shutting off entirely, but what we're putting in place today is preventing a slide in underwriting standards that extends this more broadly across the market, across a broader range of borrowers, that's fed, as it has been in the past, by expectations that future house price increases will protect everybody from the risks of the loans. And in acting today, we can do it in a manner that doesn't reverse activity, that doesn't slow the economy, that allows prudent lending, but puts underwriters, in other words, banks and building societies, not just on notice, but puts a hard firebreak in place to prevent the type of activity that in the end is in none of our interests. It's not in the interest of the borrower, it's not in the interest of the bank or the building society, and it's not in interest of anybody in this economy, because it ultimately leads to an expansion that's ephemeral, that is followed by a sharp contraction. And I'll make a last point, which is we have to recognize, whether we're calibrating monetary policy or calibrating financial stability policy, that we are still starting from quite a vulnerable position in this economy. I mentioned 140% debt to disposable income. Well, that's one of the factors which influences limited and gradual path of interest rates to achieve the inflation targets. One of the factors, there's others. But it also has an implication for why the FPC looks at indebtedness in the UK, sees it as the biggest risk. It's centered on the housing market. That's 80% plus of household indebtedness, and will be for the foreseeable future. And we've taken these steps.
At the Times. Your forecasts show a 20% rise in house prices over the next 3 years and a 15% rise in household secured debt. And you're saying that's perfectly acceptable, you're tolerating it. Doesn't that just send a message to the country that you're perfectly happy with a debt-fueled housing boom again? And how does that square with the rebalancing away from consumption? And you know, obviously that's needed for a better balanced economy.
Yeah, several things about the forecast. Just so we're on the same page in terms of the house price forecast, what we see based on current indicators, forward indicators, is that we expect momentum in the housing market to continue for the next year or so. And then our expectation, the expectation of the MPC, which the FPC relies, is that rate of growth will slow to something consistent with income. Now, that's an expectation, that's not a certainty. by putting in place this cap, we ensure, we help ensure, that if we're wrong about that, if for some reason price growth is faster because of expectations of individuals, or income growth is not as rapid because the labor market takes longer to pick up, that the slide into riskier lending is limited. So that's the first two points around it. The third point I'd make in terms of the increase in indebtedness, you have to recognize that as the housing stock turns over, as older households downsize, sell their houses, younger households purchase them, there is a natural increase in debt for a given level of house prices. The people who've lived in them for 25 years bought them at a different level than people are buying them now, and that drives about that. Last point I'll make, you rightly use the word tolerate. I wouldn't use the word happy. This is the limits of our tolerance, and that's why there's a cap in place. We'll evaluate. If we need to recalibrate, we will.
Robert Peston from the BBC. You are saying 15% of mortgages at 4.5 times income is tolerable. The Treasury is saying no more Help to Buy mortgages at 4.5 times income in its Help to Buy scheme. Is the Chancellor being a bit irrational and hysterical about this?
I distinguish what, as you're well aware, in the Help to Buy 2 scheme, mortgage guarantee scheme, in effect, all of those mortgages are also high loan-to-value mortgages as well as being high loan-to-income mortgages. That's not the case across the broader set of mortgages. So there is double risk there, if you will. And the Chancellor's announcement today fulfills his pledge made at Mansion House, and we welcome it.
Hello, Asa Bennett from the Huffington Post. Just wanted to ask, obviously, given your move on loan-to-income ratios and acting at 4.5, whereas Business Secretary Vince Cable said it should be about 3 or 3.5 to stop banks throwing petrol on the fire, I mean, why is he wrong?
Well, there's a couple of things. I mean, we look closely at the historic performance of not just loan to income, but ultimately getting to what determines one of the big determinants of whether or not a mortgage performs over time, which is the debt service ratio. So, so the total amount of debt service that a household has to pay relative to their disposable income, and at different times, at different points in the rate cycle, at different amortization periods for mortgages, different loan-to-income ratios correspond to different debt service ratios. Okay, first point. In the UK, in Canada, in Northern Europe, a variety of jurisdictions, one sees that debt service ratios of around 35-40%, once you get to those levels, when there's a shock, there tends to be a jump up in non-performance of mortgages. They become riskier mortgages. Not all of them, but on average. And with the average amortization of mortgages in the UK today, moving out towards about 27, 30 years, so they're longer amortization than in the past, with the expected path of interest rates, including that stress 3% interest rate, the expected path of interest rates, a loan-to-income ratio of about 4.75, 4.5, 4.75 corresponds to that 35%. So by restricting down into this, by restricting the total proportion of those loans and then letting the banks select the more creditworthy borrowers, their judgments have to be made. We're consistent with prudent lending practices. The 3.5-time level would have been more consistent with a period of much higher interest rates and shorter amortization. Similar experience.
Chris Giles from the Financial Times. You said you're at the tolerance of your limit of the amount of mortgage lending there is out there, but you're clearly not at the tolerance of your limit of the amount of buy-to-let mortgage lending, seeing as it's excluded. Why are you so relatively tolerant of more buy-to-let lending than first-time buyers?
Yeah, it was a very important question, Chris. And let me start, and I'm going to ask Andrew Bailey to supplement, because this goes to partly the different nature of the buy-to-let market. It's a different underwriting cycle than the individual, if you or I were to go out and get a mortgage. And it also goes to another tool that we're deploying, which is the stress test. And so we are looking at the buy-to-let market and the risks that banks are taking in extension there through the stress test. And I might just, if you'll indulge us for a second, ask Andrew to say a word about buy-to-let, but then more broadly on the stress test, because it's important that the steps we're taking today are seen in the context of other measures that have been taken, not just ending the subsidies from funding for lending and the capital subsidy, but also the MMR coming into place, so there's real discipline on standards, and the FCA oversees that, obviously, but as well the stress test, which the FPC and the PRA are overseeing, and Andrew is directly responsible for. So, Andrew?
Yes, I mean, I think the first thing I would say, just to reinforce the point, is that a buy-to-let mortgage, but I mean, a buy-to-let mortgage, by the way, of course, is the rental market, really. This is what buy-to-let is. I mean, it's a part of it, it's not the whole of it. I mean, the income dynamics and the link to household indebtedness is therefore different. That's the first point. So if you're thinking about buy-to-let, I think it's natural that you don't think about it as just a sort of a lump and put in with owner-occupier mortgages. The stress test, I mean, the stress test has in it the sort of key component, which we covered when we released the stress test paper, that there is a, you know, there's an assumed 35% fall in UK house prices from the level at the end of the fourth quarter of last year. And that goes across the piece, across the board. So that is an approach across the housing market, which will, of course, therefore allow us to test buy-to-let lending as well as the owner-occupier market. I mean, the final thing I would say, just going back to this point about it being a different market, one thing you should be clear on, it's not because we're going to ignore the buy-to-let market in terms of the supervisory oversight and observation. I mean, one of the things that follows from the FPC's announcement this morning, not only that the PRA has issued a consultation document putting what the governor has just described into effect, but we will also continue our supervisory oversight looking for signs of stress across the housing market as a whole, and that will include, of course, the buy-to-let market, because you're right, Chris, that one of the things we obviously will be looking out for is what is any impact of the measures that have been announced today in terms of other areas of the market. Do we see a transmission, if you like, to other areas, and buy-to-let would be an important one of those. So you can be assured that we will be looking closely at it.
Oh, it's the bank of zero, isn't it? Zero impact from the stress test, zero impact from the loan-to-income cap, and a zero macroprudential buffer. I mean, it's remarkable, isn't it, that you're doing nothing in the face of a credit-fueled recovery. And I was just going to wonder, technically, what is the signal on what you tweak? Suppose house prices race ahead of a 20% central projection by 2017. Which tool do you move first? I mean, how is the market to understand what the potential movement of this macroprudential buffer is going to be in future if it's zero now?
First thing, we don't target house prices. We care about indebtedness. So don't measure us on where house prices go. The question is indebtedness, and it's not just aggregate indebtedness, but it's those most vulnerable borrowers who history has shown that they do the right thing. They service their debts, but it has a big impact on the economy, and it brings the economy back into recession. So that's what we will be looking at, is how that moves. Now, it can't move above the flow of those mortgages above 4.5 times, at or above 4.5 times, cannot from this day forward be more than 15% of the portfolio. Okay? That's new. That has an impact. We think that starts to be relevant in a year, but we also think, and we put big risks around this, could be stronger, could be weaker, but we think that the housing market, or at least price dynamics in the housing market, is going to slow in about a year's time as incomes pick up. If either of those are off by a bit, then this hits now, and this is in place now. The 3% affordability cap, or test, That is what good lenders do, prudent lenders do. Everyone has to do it. That's that make that assessment. The stress test, there's no reason to come to the conclusion that the stress test is zero. As Andrew Bailey just outlined, a 35% house price shock, it's a stress scenario, it's not a prediction, just to be clear, but in conjunction with a 6% increase in the unemployment rate, stress scenario, not a prediction, sharp increase in interest rates, and a three-year recession. Do banks and building societies in this country have balance sheets today that are resilient enough to withstand that type of stress? And if they don't, the PRA and the FPC will consider actions that those institutions need to take to address it. So it would be a big mistake to look at the stress test, which is undergoing we're undergoing right now, and conclude that this is anything other than a very serious exercise that may have consequences for some banks and building societies.
Can I add one point on the zero impact? I'm afraid to challenge you. A year ago, at this press conference, we were discussing the FPC's recommendation on capital.
Yeah.
Today, if you look at the financial stability report, the FPC has essentially closed its recommendation on capital. And the reason it's closed its recommendation on capital is because of the actions that have been taken in the interim period on adjusting and raising capital and adjusting the capital position of the banking system in this country. That is not a zero impact. It is also, in my view, an essential component of supporting a durable recovery. So I really do push back on this zero impact point.
Ben Chu from The Independent. Governor, the message of these recommendations seems to be that high loan-to-income mortgages are a potential threat to an individual household's financial position. But you're limiting the number of these mortgages that banks can write. You're not preventing them writing them. So to those households that do continue to get to take out these high loan-to-income mortgages, is the bank's message to them, beware, you're taking a potential risk with your own financial stability?
Well, I think it's clear that, I mean, responsibility for any borrowing starts with the individual who's taking out the loan, taking out the mortgage, and that individual has to assess whether or not they think they can repay it for the lifetime of the mortgage. And if it's a mortgage, it's 25, it's 30 years. A lot can happen during that period to your personal prospects, to interest rates, to the economy. So there has to be an assessment there. And if you're taking out a mortgage that's a high multiple of your income, then you have to think hard about it. Now, for some individuals, first-time buyers early in their career, there's a range of individuals that can have expectation that that's a reasonable thing to do, a reasonable risk to take, because it is taking a risk. Now, the bank, the building society, has to do its own assessment of that, and recognizing that it has now a limited budget of those types of mortgages that can be made. And through that dynamic, people will be assessed, and some will get these mortgages, some won't. Somebody who was going to get one yesterday should get one today, given that there's room under the cap. But there will come a point, there may come a point, where that cap bites, and that point could come within the course of next year. But I'll make a broader point, if I may, which is that when we look at the macroeconomy as a whole, and actually Spencer, maybe expand on this, but for a second, is that we also have concerns about the overall degree of debt. So even though for an individual it can make sense, if you aggregate that as a whole, it can have a bigger macroeconomic impact, set up weakness in the future. That's a lesson we should have learned from the past, and it's a lesson we have, we think, and we're applying today. So.
Yeah, so just to pick up on the Governor's point, if you turn to page 62 of the Financial Stability Report and look at Chart B, it's just a good way of making the Governor's point in an aggregate sense. And what this chart does is just plots the level of household debt across a whole range of countries and the extent to which consumption fell following the financial crisis. And you can see there's a quite strong correlation. Those countries with that, which had the highest levels of household debt, had also saw the sharpest falls in household consumption, and this is just the aggregate implications of what we're talking about here. Is there's much micro-evidence and macroeconomic evidence that highly indebted households, in response to shocks, be it income shocks or interest rate shocks, respond disproportionately in terms of cutting back that spending, generating economic instability and hence financial instability.
Larry Elliott of The Guardian. Governor, you talk here about a graduated and proportionate response, and you clearly expect this to cool down the housing market and prevent any further action. But only somebody who didn't understand anything about Britain's recent economic history would realise that this is an economy which is quite prone to bubbles in the housing market, destabilising bubbles. What if this doesn't work? What if household debt continues to rise, house prices rise by more than you think?
Yeah.
Are there other macro-prudential tools that you've got waiting to use, or do you then, if this doesn't work, have to go for the big stick of interest rate rises?
A couple of things. First, I know my British macroeconomic history, and I know my British housing history, having first moved here in 1988 and lived through the tail end of that boom, and the euphoria that was associated with the tail end of that boom and a subsequent extremely severe bust and a recession that was made that much worse by the type of behavior that happened in the latter stages of that boom, the type of underwriting behavior, the type of borrowing behavior, and the weight of debt that was put in place that had consequences, albeit in a you know, very sharp interest rate environment move. In terms of the tools we have, we have a broad range of additional tools that we could use. Obviously, what we're announcing today, one could change the calibration of that if that were appropriate. We have an ability to make recommendations on other aspects of the portfolio of mortgages, the type of mortgages that banks and building societies extend, whether it's the amortization period, whether it's the loan-to-value metrics, other metrics around it. We could activate a sectoral capital buffer. In other words, we could ask banks and building societies to hold more capital against mortgage lending, and we could do that for reasons of the macroeconomic risks as much as reasons of the risk to the bank's balance sheets. Now, it's sensible to be fully informed by the stress test before we would consider doing something like that, and it's also sensible to use other targeted tools like this before we consider doing that. We could also activate more broadly not just a sectoral capital add-on for housing, but a broad the capital conservation buffer that was referenced earlier, which we're setting at zero given the big capital build that Andrew just referenced, but we could adjust that for macroeconomic purposes. And ultimately, we can use monetary policy to address financial stability risk. But the one point I'd make on that, aside from the fact that we have other options and we have a committee that has been mandated by Parliament to have primary responsibility to address financial stability risks, apart from all of that and the fact that we have certainly have far from exhausted our tools, we think we're acting in a graduated and proportionate fashion. At present, as per the May inflation report forecast of the Monetary Policy Committee, inflation is just getting back to target at the end of the forecast horizon. We have an ability under our remit to stretch the forecast horizon, or to stretch the period over which we return inflation to target, whether from above, which was the discussion we were having in this room about a year ago on the monetary policy side, or from below, which would be the issue if we were to use monetary policy today. But we can stretch it, but there are limits to how much we could stretch it. And so you have to consider how much one would have to move monetary policy in order to influence a sectoral financial stability risk, how long it would take, how much longer it potentially would take to get back to target, and whether that's a sensible strategy, given that you're affecting the entire economy to address a risk in a sector, albeit one as important as housing, but a sector for which you have a wide range of tools and a committee that is mandated to address exactly these types of risks.
Helia Ebrahimi, CNBC. House builders will be very happy with you today, but can you tell us a bit about these biting sanctions? What could you do to banks if they breach this 15% cap? And also, do you regret that your communication strategy has left you being characterized as an unreliable boyfriend?
Why don't I take the first one and let Andrew, the second one. Andrew, why don't you take the first one, I'll take the second one. No, I'll do it the other way around. I don't know what you'd say about it, actually, Andrew. Yeah, exactly. Look, I'm a, as colleagues are, we're dedicated central bankers. What we're focused on is faithfully delivering the mandates we have. Here today, what we're concerned about is financial stability risks, risks over the medium term that could potentially derail a promising economic expansion. And that's why we're acting. So that's what we're focused on, whether on the monetary policy side. We are making policy to achieve the inflation target. And we have provided clear guidance initially, 7% threshold, more effective than we would have expected. Other factors improved it. Subsequently, with guidance around the medium-term path of interest rates, limited and gradual moves, lots of guidance about what we, how we approach asset sales, our asset purchase facility, and also guidance that's relevant to today about who's responsible for what, the FPC for financial stability risk, the MPC and monetary policy as the last line of defense for these types of issues. So we provided all that guidance faithfully, consistently. With respect to your first question, I'm gonna bounce over to
Andrew. The question of what tools would we use? Well, first of all, as I said earlier, we'll be using very close supervisory observation and monitoring. And as I said, I mean, that will be for the application of the policy itself and looking at the consequences of the application of the policy. And that's a very close dialogue with the mortgage lenders. I expect out of that dialogue there would be an understanding of, they should be clear on what we're trying to do, and I expect to be clear on how they respond to it. Now, you'll know if you look at the legislation that we have enforcement powers available to us. On the whole, as prudential regulators, we don't use enforcement powers in the front line of our sort of our responses, but they're there. Well, they're formal enforcement powers. I mean, they're legal powers. That would be in our toolkit. There are a range of enforcement powers you can use, which are to do with penalties, and it can include restrictions on business. Yes, but as I say, as a prudential regulator, I don't tend to use that. That's not my first line of attack. I mean, frankly, you know, the first line is that, frankly, I expect institutions to respond appropriately to this.
Yeah, and I wouldn't underplay the supervisor's expectation, a policy that's been endorsed by the PRA board, nor would I expect any bank or building society in this country to take the other side of it. So there's not a story there, quite frankly.
My name is Gökhan Kurtaran from Anadolu News Agency. My question is, in the financial stability report, it says, like, under the title of Global Risk to UK Financial Stability, it says even anticipated tightening in monetary policy could present risks. For example, a rise in interest rates may expose potential fragilities from a weakening in underwriting standards and increased complexity in some of the asset classes. So if the interest rate increase to come, like, earlier than the market expectation, until that time, like, how are you planning to avoid those risks? Thank you.
Well, I think with respect to global financial stability risk related, I'll use shorthand, but risks related to the global stance of monetary policy, low for long, complacency that's driven, potentially driven by that. First and foremost, it's the global stance of policy that is most relevant. The monetary policy of the Bank of England is of interest, but I think we should be humble here and recognize that whether one's looking at spreads of peripheral European sovereigns, the covenant behavior in the U.S. high yield market, high yield spreads in general, CMBS, other things in U.S. Markets, whether you're looking across a range of those issues, it's not clear that a change in sterling rates would have a material impact on that. What needs to be from a communication perspective, what we're seeking to do is to provide guidance on the medium-term path of rates, limiting and gradual, and to sensitize market participants to the fact that the timing of the first adjustment in interest rates is going to be driven by the evolution of the economy. It's going to be a function of data. And so that's an adjustment that's born out of a positive development, which is that we've turned from recovery into an expansion. And as things move forward, one can expect that volatility is going to increase in markets, if for no other reason, the volatility is incredibly low across a wide range of markets, and the process of normalization of monetary policy, when it comes, will contribute to an adjustment.
James.
James McIntosh. Can I just follow up on the search for yield point you raised briefly there? Sorry to move it away from house prices for all the Brits in the audience. But the you provide quite a list of points where you say there's a search for yield going on, some strong areas and some where you just see a few areas. Are these areas where you think there is mispricing by the market? Is there anything wrong with the search for yield? Isn't that exactly what we should expect in an environment driven by very low interest rates? And I realize, as you say, you can't do anything about it with UK rates about Greek bond yields. But in principle, is this something that you are warning investors to be careful here? Is that the point of this?
Let me say two words, and I'm going to ask John Cunliffe to supplement. One of the things that does concern, I mean, we are concerned about this issue. We are taking some steps domestically to address some potential manifestations of it. So it's referenced, for example, in the FSR that we're looking in the PRAs, looking into leveraged lending market, commercial real estate market, the covenant standards and the underwriting standards there. And so that's a sensible thing to do in this environment, and we're doing it. And we've conducted stress tests. In fact, the stress tests that we're undertaking, aside from doing what we're doing on the housing side, looks at what could happen when interest rates move sharply and credit spreads move sharply. The last point before passing to John is that when we think about the medium term, we're very conscious that we've pushed liquidity risk into the private sector. We pushed higher capital standards there as well. As a consequence, liquidity premia should be higher than historic averages rather than lower than historic averages. Now, the confluence of the stance of global monetary policy, other factors, low volatility breeding low volatility, is meaning that liquidity premia, actually as detailed in the report, are actually well below. That's going to change at some point. You can call that, I think it's just a statement of the obvious. We can couch that as a warning, but it will adjust, and we'll try to refrain from saying we told you so. The talk, but John's just back from the G20, where they've had discussions on this and others.
I'd say there are different aspects to this risk. I mean, there are clearly risks about whether market participants have kind of properly internalized the normalization of monetary policy, but also there are risks around that normalization from unexpected, for example, geopolitical events, and whether they're actually looking at the range of probabilities there. But even if they are correctly or have internalized that in looking at the risks they're taking, there's then the question of whether, this particular point the governor raised, whether they're properly pricing the liquidity risk in today's conditions. So whether, if in the event that there's a change in conditions, they can move in and out of markets with the ease that they're predicting, and how much compensation they're asking in the pricing for taking that liquidity risk, And we've the FPC asked the banks here to do an exercise last year to look at what would happen when monetary policy rates normalized, and were they kind of looking at the risks of that, and actually the amplifiers, the way that will play through the system. And the initial, we got an initial response from that, and that's fed into the construction of the stress test that Andrew was talking about. So that's something we're kind of testing further on. But we also want to make the market aware of the possibilities here, so that people start to price and charge for the risk they're taking.
So at the moment, you think they're not correctly charging for the risk they're taking?
At the moment, I think if you look at the liquidity premium, and if you look at other areas, there is a risk that they're not doing that. It's for them to do it, but it's for us to remind them of where the risks are in this area.
James. James Sermon from the Daily Mail. You've talked about the cap potentially biting this year. I just wonder whether you could spell out for us, will this make it more difficult for borrowers, particularly those in London and the South East and first-time buyers, to get a mortgage? And also, this 15% cap, is it a movable target? Or is it fixed?
Yeah. So just one point of clarification. I said within a year. So we provide it buried in there on one of the pages. There's our central case forecast of what percentage of mortgages would be above 4.5, and so you can see it's basically within a year from now. So it's not imminent for both of those groups. Whether you're in the Southeast or a first-time buyer, or you're a first-time buyer in the Southeast, there's still room. These types of mortgages. It's up to the institutions, it's up to the banks and building societies to decide, to whom to extend these. But if the market evolves as we expect, now nothing ever evolves exactly as we expect, but if it evolves as we expect, there'll be room for the demand, the natural demand that's there. But if for some reason prices grow more rapidly, incomes grow less rapidly, this will constrain this type of lending. And that's in everybody's interests. That's in the interests of even people who don't get mortgages down the road, because mortgages at as high a level, I should say, a higher multiple down the road, because the shift into mass high loan-to-income lending, risky lending, to not just those who can afford it, those who have prospects of growing incomes that ultimately can afford it, but a broad swath of the population. It's that shift that we've seen in the past. It's that shift which gives that temporary boost to the expansion, but sets up a deeper recession in the future that hurts everybody. And it's particularly important that we're vigilant to that and that we act early against that, because we're starting from a very vulnerable position, which is a product of the last time we saw this movie. So that's what we're doing. That's why we're doing what we're doing.
And the 15% point, is the 15% cap, is that a movable target?
Well, I mean, we don't, as we sit here today, obviously we thought long and hard about the calibration of this. We think it's the right way it's calibrated. We're talking about it in terms of how we expect the market to evolve, so it's not, we think that it's relevant, but we could adjust it. We definitely could adjust it. And as to Larry Elliott's question, there's other tools that we could put in place if necessary. If we thought other measures were necessary today, we would have done them today. But look, one cannot make a perfect comparison to monetary policy, but in financial stability, this is a repeated game. We meet every quarter. If necessary, we take decisions, we make adjustments, and we would do so. But this is what we think is a proportionate graduated response at this stage, promotes a sustainable evolution of the housing market. I would remind, again, that there is this stress test that is ongoing, reports back in the last quarter of this year, and there may be, we don't know, it's underway, but there may be consequences from that stress test for the institutions.
Sue.
Hi, Sue Chan from The Telegraph. I think you answered most of my questions. So are we to assume that the committee's policies of choice are these stress tests, both for borrowers and banks and these LTI caps, and you know, if the upside scenario were to emerge, that you turn the dial up on these policies rather than reach into your toolbox for other measures? And also, how important is the wage growth component or income growth component for your central scenario? Because obviously wages aren't growing at the 4% levels that you project at the moment anyway.
In terms of, look, we'd be foolish to rule anything out. We do have a wide range of tools, and as per the Manchin House announcement by the Chancellor, some of those, in fact, an extension of those, we're going to be out consulting over the summer for directive powers around portfolio composition of mortgages, and that could be legislated before the end of this Parliament. So that adds to the tools. So we shouldn't rule any of those out, but we should use them in as, you know, we have to take judgments about what's going to be most effective, what's addressing the issue that's most relevant. We think the affordability test and the cap today are the best ways to get at the indebtedness issue and are appropriately calibrated. But you know, we'll see how things evolve. If the way lenders react is to make every loan just less than the cap, well, I expect we would respond. That's not a, don't want to tie the hands of the committee, but that's pretty reasonable. You asked, sorry, I can't recall your last question.
If the wage growth component. Wage growth,
yeah, no, wage growth is important. Wage growth is important to all aspects of our forecast. It's central to the MPC's forecast. Some of the house price recovery, we would think, is the product of expectations of future wage growth. So if that wage growth doesn't come through, some of the recovery is less sustainable. On top of that, the cap would bite more quickly, and it would have consequences for prices. And but that's a that's a fundamental that's driving things. It's the fundamental, i.e. incomes not coming through, that would affect the outcome.
Can you just pass the
microphone back to Tim? Tim Wallace from Citi AM. Governor, a practical point really on how this is going to be implemented straight away. You mentioned that you expect banks to apply these new conditions immediately. Did you warn them in advance, or should we expect a little bit of disturbance as they right away have to apply these tougher affordability tests and so on?
Yeah, thanks. You wouldn't have had time. There's a consultation to read it. There's a consultation paper that's coming out from the PRA which describes how the PRA would implement this, and in essence, the way it would implement it is to look at the flow of lending over a quarter, and it would strike that first quarter in October, so September, August, and back into July. So effectively, the decisions today, the way the mortgage pipeline works, the decision of the types of mortgages you're extending today will fall into that quarter. The calculation will be based off of that. So understanding that, it changes behavior today. On top of that, as Andrew Bailey had outlined, the expectation of the supervisor is that banks would move in this direction, would implement this pending the formal imposition. And then on top of that, Tim, is the reality that on an institutional basis, the vast majority, tempted to say all, effectively all to my knowledge, of institutions are at or below the cap as they sit today. So it would take them to change their behavior, which is not a good idea, vis-a-vis your relationship with your supervisor, to try to get under the cap. So there's a variety of mechanisms. I think, Andrew, I've covered the essence of it. Is that
absolutely
fair?
Absolutely, and I think that the key point, as the Governor just said, is, I mean, I don't sense in all the conversations I have that we are pushing against a tide here in terms of the overall approach to underwriting standards and risk management. So this is very much a reinforcement of that.
Now, we are just about out of time, but I think we've got time for one last question from Sam.
Sam Fleming from the FT. Actually, it's two very brief questions, if I could. One on the 15% cap. Is that by volume or value? Could you clarify that? And second of all, you mentioned in the report 81 issuance, very racy topic, I realise. You seem to be concerned about the degree to which investors are pricing in the risks associated with these instruments. I just wondered if you could explain a bit more on that.
Yeah. First, on the lending, it is by volume. In other words, number of mortgages, so it's 15% number. But as we say in there, we will monitor values. So if we do see a shift in behavior that's gaming, if you will, the system, or tries to, we will, the supervisors will act. I mean, there's an advantage. It's another advantage of having within one institution joined up decision-making, participation, discussion of the measures. Everybody understands. I mean, they're independent entities, the FPC and the PRA board, but in taking the decisions, the PRA board understands the objectives of the FPC, and supervisors will look to make sure they're implemented. Obviously, we wouldn't object if people, for their own credit reasons, assessment of risks in the market end up being, well, you know, changing behavior and writing fewer and fewer higher loan-to-value mortgages and moving down the risk spectrum. On the AT1, the COCO issue, I'll pass to John to touch on it.
Yeah, first of all, I think AT1 has now come in as part of the regulatory capital stack, and the rules around it, the tax rules, are much clearer. So it's an instrument that we expect people to use, and there's nothing wrong with the instrument itself. But there has been pretty sharp increase in the issuance, particularly as in continental Europe. And as kind of money has come back into the banking system in Europe, and the key question is: do people understand well the risks they're taking around this instrument? This is an instrument which, at a certain level of capital, will trigger and will convert into capital. And it has been a sharp increase. The question really is: are the people who are coming back in this instrument properly thinking about the risks and properly pricing the risks? And again, my earlier point: it's our job just to remind them, of that.
And I'll just supplement on the last point, which is that the flip side of that is the quality of the AT1. So where is the trigger for conversion? And as you're probably aware, Sam, all the AT1 that's been issued by UK institutions have a higher trigger, the 7% trigger, which is a much more effective instrument, in our judgment, to fulfill its role as going concern capital. So both sides of that, and it provides additional comfort for us as supervisors and for the FPC as a whole in terms of the protection of the core of the system.
Good. Thanks very much indeed. I'm afraid we've reached the final whistle, but thank you all very much indeed for coming.